Hi, welcome to Uber Micro Repairs. On the healing bench today, we have something we wasn't expecting to get just yet. One of these. And you've probably guessed what's wrong with this. Yep, the stick doesn't work. There's a bit of a backstory on this one. This has came from a customer. It's all fully boxed, and as you can see, it's in half decent condition there. Screen's really good. Customer bought this off Facebook as faulty. Unfortunately, it couldn't go back on warranty because the seller had actually taken it apart. Whenever we get an inquiry about a new device such as this, we always tell the customer to exercise their right to return it under warranty, but unfortunately that is not the case with this due to the seller taking it apart. Let's just have a quick scan around the chassis here. It's a very nice unit, quite a bit of weight, it's quite stout, not much flex in it, it's quite good. Got a couple of little ding marks around the screen here. It looks like we've got a couple of little dig marks around the screen here. There's a mark there next to the PS button, one there. Yeah, we've got a couple of dig marks there and there. So yeah, this unit has definitely been opened before. So let's turn it on. Confirm the fault. So settings, there we go, network, setup, connection, wait for it to find my Wi-Fi, there we go, and okay, we're good with the D-pad, but the left stick, there's no up and down, there's left and right. But yeah, up and down, it's not working. So that is the issue that the customer is complaining of. So up and down on the left stick is completely dead. So now that we've confirmed the faults, we need to get this apart and take a look at that analog stick. The analog sticks in these, I believe, are the exact same ones that are in the PSVR 2 handsets, and you cannot get replacement analogs for these just yet. I'm sure they will be available at some point, but checking all of the usual getting spots, and I've put the feelers out there with quite a few suppliers, and every single one of them have come back to me empty-handed. They're just waiting, one, to either find a supply for them, or two, waiting to be copied, and at that point they will be all over AliExpress, I would imagine. So that's enough jibber, let's get this apart. So you guys know the drill, I'll speed run the disassembly. And just for anyone playing along at home, this is the cap that I've just taken off here. This is a standard PlayStation 5 controller cap, and yeah, you can see the difference there. And yep, the shaft and the dome is different, also the height by the looks of it. Yeah, you can really see the difference there. So yep, standard ones will definitely not fit, although the actual shaft size is right and that's got a good fit to it. So the internal hole is the same as a standard Alps analog, but obviously they're too big. All right, so we've got two black screws, short machine screws. I don't want to slip here because I'm right next to the screen. And another small black machine screw. And this is very reminiscent of a Joy-Con. So lift the flap up gently and tease it out. Put that flap down, because if you leave that sticking up and you brush your finger against it, it will come off. Let's get this guy under the microscope and see what we can do. This is the offending article, and it looks brand new. It really does. No dirt, grime or anything in there. And just give you a full 360 view of it. Five lines that are going into the flex, and then we've got something on the outside there which isn't connected to anything on the right there, and that's the underside. And believe me when I say you cannot find these anywhere online, you really can't. Nothing else will work with the same footprint, height, just everything. So you can't use any Switch, PSP, PS Vita. I've even checked on Alps's website themselves, these are not listed, plus many other sites and suppliers, and these are completely unobtainium. Yes, there is a push down click as well, so hopefully you can hear that. So the next thing that I want to do is actually get this thing apart, get that flex out of this chassis and see what's going on. So let's get on with that. So we've got this frame across the top, and it looks like it comes apart quite easy. That looks like it comes off nice and easy. Try not to bend it. There we go. That's off. And now we've got these tangs. Oh, these are dodgy. If they're anything like Alps, if they're anything like Alps modules, no, this one's a little bit broken. This is brand new, but it's broken. The tangs here, once you've bent them two, possibly if you're lucky three times, they will just fracture and break off. So I hope we can actually save these. So let's bend those up carefully. They're quite tough. Don't want to distort the metal base here, so. And I don't mind if I ruin my tweezers, I've got plenty of spares. So I only want to bend it up as much as I need to, and I don't want to dig at the plastic either too much, but I've got to have something to lever against. I don't know if I can get these guys in here. Now that's moved up a little bit, like so. Ah, that's doing it. Yep. And it went too far. Ouch. Okay. So we've got three wheels on the wagon now. Don't know until you know, and now we know. Yep, I wasn't wrong. Those are delicate. I'm going to go in this corner now, and I'm not going to put anywhere near as much pressure. Okay, wish me luck. Okay, let's go with that. Okay, just bend that up slightly so I can get these guys underneath it. And again, just very careful. Third one. Super careful. I don't want to get it fully upright. I don't want to stress it out too much. Okay, so we can add, there is some springiness in the base here. So hopefully that will help us. Oh, we've got clips here. Clips here as well. Okay, well that's good. So that doesn't make me feel too bad about busting that clip. Still not great. Okay, so. Got to be careful because we've got a hinge here. See this axle here? And when we move it, it moves as well. So we don't want to distort the plastic that that is riding on. Just pokes the plastic, not great. Still feels okay. I think I've got that moved. Yes, there we go. Okay, so we've got that clip off. Can we do the same the other side? I'm conscious of this flex, I don't want to crease it. I've just moved that. Didn't want to do that. That's not good. There we go. Can't push it from the bottom because I will put that clip back on. Okay, I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do is try and shimmy this out. Okay, there we go. Yep, and just as expected, this is just like a PSP analog and a Joy-Con. I like to keep everything somewhat in place rather than exploding everywhere. Okay, we'll just pull that up slightly. I don't want to dig on that flex. Okay, so we pulled the flex out. And we can lift this metal can off, he says confidently. And something pinged out, brilliant. Okay. What's going on here then? This is why I wanted to keep it all in place. Apologies for my shaking. Okay, so there's the flex and the push down. And these are the carbon tracks here. And they don't look too bad. What I will do is just put a tiny amount of alcohol on a brand new clean Q-tip, and we'll just give them a very gentle wipe over. And there we go, so they're all clean now. There's very slight wear marks on them, but that is by no means worn out, that is practically brand new. The next thing to look at is this. I don't know if this was me or what, but you've got these little claws here. Let's get that in, there we go. So we've got these little claws, these little tangs, and then you've got these little spikes here. So those we go, so when we move it left and right, that moves left and right without it all coming apart, like so. This is extremely fiddly. Okay, get him situated like so, push him home. So when you move the stick, see how it all works now. There you go. Where this went and which way it went. Oh, actually, I think I've figured it out. I think it goes here. But which way? So, unfortunately, we don't know if the up and down, this slider or that slider, I can't remember which way is up and down now because I've rotated it that much. But with the way I lifted off the rear metal can, I do not know whether one of these was out of alignment or whether it could have been just the dirt that was on the flex. I guess that will be a mystery. We just do not know. That way, yeah, I would say. Right, yes, because this will be for the push down. Right, this will be for the push down. And I would imagine that nub, that's symmetrical, so that's handy. So that will be for the L3 push down micro switch. Get him sat home. So the most difficult part is actually handling this thing, making everything move. Okay, so that was really difficult to do. I think those sliders are still located correctly, but before I bend any of these pins back, let's give this stick a quick test. Here's the portal. We've got our analog module. It's still in bits. The clips haven't been bent over, but I think this is good enough to at least test. So let's get him reinstalled. Not convinced that he's completely home. Let's have a look under the microscope. Okay, I've just turned it a little bit so I can get to it a bit easier. That flap is not staying up, which it should do. Okay, we can actually see right into the connector now, and we can see that those pins here are definitely lined up with the carbon tracks. So that is home and we're up against this line. So there we go. Okay, cool. Okay, you guys remember as before, D-pad worked in moving the cursor, but the analog would only do left and right. Okay, we've got left and right. Yay. There we go. We have up and down. Cool. There we go. It works. Okay, let's get this reassembled. You guys know the drill. I'll speed run the reassembly. Okay, I'll just pause here for a second. Can you hear that? That's L2. R2. That feels really spongy compared to that one. That one's got a nice snap to it. That one's dull. We can see here we have a spring, and that's what gives it the snap back. Without that spring, you're just relying on the rubber. I actually have one right here. The rubber to spring it back, which will feel mushy. And if we look on the other side, yep, we're missing a spring. And yeah, it's just the rubber there that's springing that back. So yeah, that one being on the inside here is nicely protected. You can't knock it or anything, but this one out here in the open, maybe from a previous person levering it, because I didn't lever around here. I levered up the top here to get the button out here, but I did not lever anywhere around here where the spring is. So we'll just replace that spring as well. So I've got a whole bunch of PS5 springs here. They're really starting to break on the controllers now, so I'm replacing quite a lot of these. We've got to hook it over that bit there, but without it springamathinging. Try that again. Get that in. And then that rests on this little nub sticking out here. Okay, so there's like a little hook here that goes through, and then there's like a little hook here as well, which that rides up against. Then we've got to bend this over, and there's like a little fork here, and we need to get that up and round without it pinging off and blinding me. Bring it round and into the hook. There we go. Cool. Cool, they sound perfect now. Excellent, glad I caught that. Little things like that is just a natural part of the repair service that we offer. So yeah, if your controller comes in for stick drift or LBRB not working or sticky buttons, everything gets checked and tested, and yeah, things like that just get repaired as part of the price, so you have a fully functioning device returned to you. Anyway, on with the reassembly. And I think that will conclude the repair on this left analog on the PlayStation Portal. As you saw earlier, it's very, very fiddly. I've got, you know, tweezers, I've got a proper microscope, and even then, it was really, really tricky. Again, as I predicted, I used one of these as an example. Bending those tabs off, we saw one of them break. And I only had three of them left, and they were getting a little bit ropey just from moving them just the once. So yeah, if all of those tabs do break off, I'm pretty sure with the chassis and everything, it would actually clamp it down perfectly okay, but your mileage may vary. Again, when I took the module apart, it sort of like exploded apart a little bit, so I can't actually get to the exact reason why up and down was not working. However, looking at the construction, the up and down slider, because you've got the fork, and then it had a rod that went in it, and as you move the stick, it moved the slider. The only thing really that I can think of, because that up and down was completely dead, I would have expected, like with analog sticks, when the carbon track wears out or if the rotor's damaged in some way, you would see some sort of jumping or jittering, you would see some sort of input, but it was completely dead. So the only thing I think of is that shaft had jumped out of the fork, and the fork was moving, and it just wasn't engaging with the slider. The carbon track on the film looked good. So I saw no reason to replace that. There's two little lines from the copper tracks moving on it, but those weren't really wear marks, they were just making it go shiny. So I'm confident this will work perfectly fine from now on. So I'm really happy with that repair. If you have any issues with consoles, controllers, or anything like this, give us a shout. All of our details are in the description below. And as always, I hope you enjoyed the video and take care.